see that.
Okay.
And when you're talking, they can probably relate to it a little better.
All right. Okay.
Yeah.
It is also live on YouTube right now.
Has it started already? Yes. Yeah. Okay. So students like Rajeshwari just said, you can just check the link of her Instagram page, and so that while she's talking about it, you can connect with it. Yes, I guess we can start now. And
we have Monica, ma'am.
Rajeshwari, how are you, beta?
Hi, ma'am. Ekdam badhiya. How are you, ma'am?
Nice to see you after so long, huh?
Same, ma'am. It's been so long.
So it's good to see you. Yeah, I think it's already 11. So, Dr. Rohini, we can commence the session. Yeah.
Yes, sure, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. So good morning to one and all present here. My name is Vedanti Sharma, and I welcome you all to the Masterclass Alumni organized by the School of Business at Oro University. And as per the undying tradition of Oro University, we will first begin the session with Guru Vandana and observe a few minutes of silence.
Oh.
Thank you so much, everyone. At the onset of today's session, I would like to welcome our alumni speaker for today, Ms. Rajeshwari Kejriwal. And I'd like to also welcome our panelists for today, Dr. Monica Suri, Dr. Rohini Bhatt, and Dr. Krupa Rao. And of course, welcome to all the panelists who have joined us today and participants. Now, I'd like to quickly start the session with a brief introduction of our prestigious university. Oro is a premier university of integral and transformational learning for future leaders. Oro believes in value-based education that must not be limited to purely academic learning. At Oro, the focus is to develop all facets of an individual to ensure holistic development in mental, vital, physical, and spiritual education. About our masterclass today, it is an initiative taken by the School of Business at Oro University to provide a platform to our many alumni to showcase their talent and share their achievements and experiences. Now I request Dr. Monica Suri to kindly give her opening remarks and take the session forward.
Thank you, Vedanti. And once again, I can't express my happiness as one of the module leader and one of the facilitator for your respective batch, Rajeshri, because I saw you people growing and being groomed right from first day of your entry at Oro University and then exit from Oro University. And I, though you were already a very good student right from beginning, I saw you getting involved not only in academic aspects of your curriculum, but I saw you very active in managing events and organizing various trips for your respective batch of student. And I still remember few of the memories that we had when we went out of Surat, you know, to Pondicherry and various other places together as a group of faculty and students. So as she has already explained to you about the main purpose of having this masterclass, alumni masterclasses, first to connect our existing group of students to the alumni to whom they might not have seen earlier. And the second aspect is, like, we want that being very important stakeholder of School of Business, we want that you should also get connected and get involved and engaged in various academic and non-academic aspects of your own School of Business at Oro University. And third thing is, like, just to know about your progression in life, where you have reached and what you achieved since the time you left Oro University, and how Oro University learnings and groomings, and specifically with respect to the integral approach to learning that you experienced in the form of teaching learning pedagogy at Oro University. We want you to share your all these, you know, life moments at Oro University, and later how Oro University learnings have helped you in your day-to-day life. So basically, these are the you know, main objectives which we have defined for this particular masterclass. I think today it could be 7th or 8th masterclass that we are organizing, if I'm not wrong. So we had many of the alumni from various programs of School of Business, from MBA, BBA, BCom, Family Business Management, various programs we actually got connected to through our alumni to our existing group of students, so that they can ask you questions. They can also learn from you through peer-to-peer kind of learning, which is one of the approach that we follow at Oro University. So I'm equally excited to know and learn from you today, because now today you are on the other side. Earlier you used to be on this side of the class, and we are so proud to see your achievements. And I was just going through your profile and the kind of contributions you have made to your respective sector in last many years, and I feel proud as a mentor and as a part of School of Business, as one of your facilitators, that you know, whatever we aimed for you, you are making us feeling proud day after day. And this is what is expected out of each and every alumni of School of Business. And I don't want you to leave here only. I want that this masterclass should not be your first and last masterclass. You need to keep on approaching us in future also, wherever you feel that this is the right time for me to go back to my younger siblings at Oro University School of Business and just to make them get updated about one particular domain which you feel they should know, you know, as a management student. So I'm sure this relationship is long lasting and never ending, and you will keep coming to our university in future as well. And now, without taking much time, I'll hand over the session again to you know, Vedehi, to take it further for you. And looking forward for a great learning from you this time, because you've already learned so much from us. It is time for us to have a collaborative approach to learning. So thank you for joining us. And on behalf of Oro University, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Honorable Dean and Registrar, I welcome you on behalf of everyone for this masterclass. Thank you so much for joining. Thank you. Yeah. It's over to you, Bitta, for further proceedings. Yeah.
So I would like to introduce our today's speaker before moving on with the Masterclass alumni. So Rajeshwari Kejriwal, she has completed her BBA in marketing from Oro University. She has done her MA English with cultural studies from Christ University. She's also done a 9-month holistic skills program from Good Shepherd Finishing School, Udi. She is a founder of Both Self-Care, which is a new age, clean, convenient and conscious personal care brand for radical youth. The aim is to provide the meaningful as well as self-care personal care products to create an inclusive beauty positive community, which is going to be launched earlier in the next year. She's also the co-founder of Sandook Crafts. It is an e-retail and export platform for the Indian handlooms and handicrafts, a passion with a project which was born out of deep appreciation and care for art and artisans in the country, which is going to be launched earlier in the next year as well. She has been the senior editorial executive for the Lead Start Publishing, which is an English language publisher in fiction, non-fiction poems, based out of Mumbai, where she has worked for almost 2 years. She has also been the VP for the marketing and the PR for Isaac India. She has led the marketing and the PR team for the world's largest youth-run organization, Isaac Surat Chapter, and she's facilitated strategy and execution for all the marketing activities for global volunteering and internship programs, along with all the events which has been organized locally. Yes.
Thank you so much, Sakshi, for the very prompt introduction. And Ms. Rajeshwari, you may start your presentation now.
Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you so much, Monica ma'am, Rohini ma'am, Krusha ma'am, Vedanti and Sakshi, for such a beautiful introduction and welcome to the session. When this session started and the Guru Vandana played, I felt like I was at Oro again, because that was the dream every time we would start a session, and it was beautiful. Thank you so much for that. And yes, ma'am, all the memories are with me, carrying them forward wherever I go. And I am hoping that I live up to the expectations of the session today. And so I would like to begin with a quote from a book that I was skimming again recently. It's called The Psychology of Money. It's written by Morgan Housel and was published in 2020. And the quote goes like, having strong sense of controlling one's life is more dependable predictor of positive feelings of well-being than any of the objective conditions of life we have considered. So what he's trying to say is that if you feel like you're in control, you will have better feeling of well-being. And this is completely opposite to what I'm going to present today, which is leap while you can. Because I've always believed that a little bit of letting go and a little bit of letting loose is very important to see where life takes you. So my question to all of you is, do you all know what you want to do after this? What next? And while you think of that answer, I'm going to share my presentation. Is my screen visible? Right. Yes, so, does anybody have it figured out as to what they're going to do next?
Any student would, if you would like to say, you can unmute yourself and interact with Ms. Rajeshwari.
Else use the chat box. I think this is meant for virtual discussion only. Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Well, you're asking career-wise, right? Have we figured out what we're doing, what we are planning to do, or like existentially?
Well, both can do. Both will do.
Because I think most of the students will hesitate in answering. So I think at least because Sakshi and I are friends, okay, I can say for ourselves that you know, we are definitely passionate about business and we want to work in marketing and PR. So that's our zone for sure. That's what we've thought so far.
Lovely. You can help me with my startup as well.
Yes.
Right. So I will not tell you about myself, you know, at the very beginning, because I guess you're going to find out about it while the session goes on. So
Rajeshwari, I think we have another message in the chat box. So I'll just read it out.
Yes, please.
Yeah. Kishan Chawla says, yes, I know that I'll do CFA after this, but
he doesn't know what he wants to do
after that. Yeah.
All right. So, you know, I mean, I like to answer this question for myself from the very beginning of my journey at Oro, because, you know, after you leave school, you feel like, oh my God, what am I going to do now? It's college and I will be out in the world meeting new people, not in a uniform. And what next, right? I keep writing in my college projects and school projects that I want to make an impact, or I want to change the world, or I want to change myself. But it is through this learning at the university and meeting new people and exploring new events is when you find out what you're really good at. And the answer to this, I realized, was it's okay to not know. It's okay to let loose. So moving on to the next phase of the presentation, perks of being an experimental firstborn. So this is something about me that I have started to love recently. Earlier, I felt like my brother, his entire routine or his entire upbringing was so organized because they knew exactly what to make him do or what exactly not to make him do. But I was the experimental firstborn. Taekwondo bhi sikha, dance bhi sikha, painting bhi sikha, singing bhi sikha. Whatever you can think of on the earth, on the face of the earth, I was taught. And eventually, what that did to me was I became an adaptable person who would, you know, manage being jack of a few or many trades and adjust in whatever environment was around me. So I guess that worked out pretty well. If I could just get a second. And the reason why I don't feel like it's something that, you know, is such a bad thing, because now I feel like I've developed this courage, maybe even, you know, over positivity about taking bold or interesting decisions about my life as to what I'm going to do ahead with it. And you're soon going to realize why I say that. Moving on to the second part. So what happens when you're skilled at anything and everything around the house or out in the world is that you get a hat for every occasion. Now, what I do believe is that life is but a series of leaps in different settings. So, you know, it doesn't end at one leap. It just goes on from one to the other and then the other and then the other. And you realize, okay, this is a fun ride or this is a roller coaster. And then you decide the next, you know, next line of thought or next line of action. So beginning with business and marketing at Oro University and learning of leadership and PR at ISEC, this was an interesting journey because we were being taught in a pedagogy wherein we were learning only one subject per day, right? So there was an hour of lecture, then there was an hour of us watching videos or any visual content related to the topic, us getting a task as to what are we supposed to do with this knowledge that we just gained and preparing for it. And the fourth hour was presenting what we just prepared, which made for a very interesting way to learn things like economics or behavioral organization behavior, marketing for that matter, etc. So, and apart from that, Ori University provided us with an environment wherein it wasn't just academics, so it wasn't this pedagogy that we were, allowed to indulge in, but we had an array of clubs and we had an array of activities that we could organize for the students. I remember organizing with my band a concert for ourselves in the third year, and we had a beautiful concert with Bonfire and the band performing for around two, three hours at the university in the evening. And that was beautiful. And that is why it makes Oro such a special space, because you don't just get to hone your academic skills, but you can be anything you want and they make you believe that you can. And that is another that I know, that is another reason why I know that yes, I can do or I can take these leaps that I've always been, thinking of taking. So thanks to Oro University. And apart from that, while I was at the university, I was also working with ISEC, which is world's largest youth-run organization. And what it necessarily does is it provides students or people that we send outside, but we also create projects with NGOs and corporates here in the city so that people from outside can come here. And there's this environment of cultural exchange and immense learning. So I actually feel like since I was pursuing marketing at Ori University and I was working with the marketing team at ISEC, it made for a very, very wholesome experience and learning experience for me. And from there, I pursued a family dream, which was, which I'll talk about in the next slide, which was life and other fancy skills. Now, this is such a vague thing to say, but it actually is like that. So it was a family dream for, the girls in the family to attend Good Shepherd Finishing School, because it would make for a wholesome individual. They teach you fashion designing, they teach you culinary arts, they teach you housekeeping, they teach you business English by Cambridge. They have Duke of Edinburgh Award, where you indulge in adventure sports, music, social service. So there isn't, I always used to say that to my mother in Hindi when she would call me in the evenings when I was in Uti at Good Shepherd. And I'd be like, Mamma, itna to meko pata hai ki main bhookhi nahi marungi. Which is, something. Because it just makes you ready for, it just gives that confidence that no matter where you are, if it needs fixing, okay, you can do this because you just did it at an event that you organized, right? And that is how the learning becomes practical, the learning becomes experiential. And I'm so immensely thankful that I've always bumped into such organizations, into such universities or schools where it was facilitated. And after that, life took a very interesting turn. I went to Christ University, Bangalore, to study English and Cultural Studies as a part of my master's program. Now, that happened almost suddenly. When I was leaving the university, when I was leaving Good Shepherd Finishing School, I was editing and heading the team of a school magazine there. And I would often talk to the dean, Mrs. Neeta Natarajan, about, how this experience is so enriching for me and that I love, curating these poems or articles. And I've had similar experiences even at my school, SR International School, where I was writing and editing for the newspaper for EIS Express. And slowly and gradually with these counseling sessions with the dean, she and I realized that my calling, or, you know, at least there is a shot that I need to take at language. And so, you know, when I returned from GSFS, I started looking for courses outside of India because I wanted to explore something which I haven't explored as yet, or a place where I haven't been yet. And I was reading through the curriculum of the King's College London, which is a very, very long shot because I am a BBA student who took a year's break and wanted to go to King's College London for cultural studies. And I soon realized that it's not going to be very easy, or it's almost impossible to get in there, or you know, even in colleges in Pune, because you need a bare minimum of BA in English or any other subject, right? But I got lucky again, and you can call it serendipity, that Christ had introduced this program called English with Cultural, English with Cultural Studies that year. And I was like, you know what, they just introduced it, but I think they're the only ones who are actually going to take me in it. So I applied, and they did take me in it. And I was never the same, is, you know, what I would say. Because after studying business, administration, marketing, learning how to sew and learning how to mend a shoe and write business English and study French and cooking, learning how to cook, I was in this classroom where people were talking about important ideas of people like Plato and Aristotle. And I was forced to look deep within. And I realized that there is so much that we don't see on the outside, and even on the inside. So there's this Plato's theory, which in which he says that there are these three men that are hanging upside down facing the wall of a cave. And all that they see all their lives is the reflection of what the cave shows them. They haven't seen what actually lies outside the cave. So their entire lives, they only believed what they saw. But when they were released, they stepped out into the world and saw that it was just an imitation of everything that there is outside there. And that is how I felt as well. I felt like a released person or a released cave woman who came out and saw that there is politics involved in every idea that we talk about, in every piece of literature. There are theories to linguistics. There are cultural studies was an amalgamation of economic, maths, language, culture, politics. So it was just, it was in short, and you know, if I oversimplify it, cultural studies was a 360 degree perspective on whatever you're studying or the subject matter, which made things extremely interesting. And those 2 years, I call them the golden period of my life, is that, like, you know, all the glasses, and I could see clearly. And so after this, after the course of MA, I realized that, you know, maybe I, since I've been reading a lot more than I ever was before MA, I wanted to researching and interned with Lead Start Publishing in the second year of my MA. And things went really well. I was handling writing pitches for books so that they could be pitched to companies like Netflix and Amazon Prime for adaptation into movies or web series. And I realized that in the monsoon of 2019, I got a call from my internship mentor at Lead Start saying, you know what, Rajeshwari, I have a seat empty here. Do you want to take the job? And I was like, what is the job? And she's like, you got to read all the books that come in as submissions. I was like, yes, hell yes, I want this job. And I just leaped into it. And my entire job involved, it was this really interesting smart tool development, wherein I was manually developing this tool of segregating books on the basis of their genre, their writing quality, the language used, or the, you know, the topicality or the agility of the topic of the book, and give it scores so that at a point of time, this tool could itself do that, right? And in those 2 years, I think that tool was developed up to 90%. And apart from that, I was also handling their IP rights. Again, like I said, writing pitches for books that are already published and taking them to companies like Alt Balaji, taking them to companies like Amazon Prime or Hotstar, and seeing the possibility of converting. And taking it to the people, it was under me. And I enjoyed that journey thoroughly because I got a chance to interact with people in the entertainment industry for the very first time. And to see how they think and, you know, how they see entertainment is amazing because all their life, they dedicated their entire life to understanding film and making them. So it was an interesting journey and a very diverse one. And now the question is, what happened next? So in the Diwali of 2020, something happened. I realized that due to COVID, my growth barrel, my growth meter is sort of, you know, stagnating. And I felt like there is nothing coming out and there is nothing that I am adding to this right now. And I felt like, okay, I need to take a break. So I took a sabbatical from Lead Start. And in those days, there was this conversation going on at home. So as a matter of fact, my entire family is very passionate about Ayurveda. And, you know, be it my 72-year-old grandfather or my 8-year-old cousin, they all know the home remedies or Ayurvedic remedies to your daily problems, right? So they're very handy that way. Ki agar sardi hui hai, to haldi le lo. Or agar gala kharab hua hai, to namak ka pani ka gargle kar lo. So, you know, they're very interested in Ayurveda and apothecary. And that is how we started discussing that, you know, why not make a personal care brand out of this thing and, you know, use this knowledge to, you know, develop it into a full-fledged business. And that is when I started working on it full-fledged because I knew that, you know, I needed to move somewhere. I needed to experience movement somewhere. And that is why I wrote this little poem for you all, and which says, when locked down, I was bogged down, but didn't want to back down. So I looked in and around, and when an idea touched down, with it, I went to town and will make it count. Now, this literally struck me last night. So the reason why I wrote this is because since I was in the bounds of my home and feeling stuck, and this idea comes to me, and I went on with it immediately. I felt like this could really turn out to be something. So I started, you know, looking at some stats and, you know, reading some Wikipedia pages as well. I'm not going to lie about it. And also some blogs and, you know, looking at beauty influencers. And I realized that this is not just this won't just be a profitable business, but there is also so much gap in it, right? And that is why I felt like we must find the gap and we must leap into it. Now, let's begin with both first. How did both come into picture? While researching, I came across this term called waterless beauty. And I was wondering, what is that supposed to mean? And I opened some reports, industry reports, and I realized that this is the next big thing. And I was like, okay, but how? And then I see stats of only 2% of people on the earth clean drinking water or access to clean sanitation water. And that made me realize that, you know what, I gotta relate these two. So I went to some other stats which told me how much water waste is the beauty industry generating. And that was the evening when I was trying to develop a product for people like us, you know, rad millennials who want to be out there, are too out there, and, you know, want to travel, want to see the world, want to hustle. And I realized that there is a need, there's a gap here. Matlab apan pe, you know, we don't have the messaging, or we don't relate to the messaging of komal twacha, you know, all of that things we don't relate to. So I realized, why not make portable waterless products that for the entire life cycle of which is, you know, water conscious. Because of course there is, even right now with all the products that are being developed at Booth, we're only 95% waterless because it's not that easy. And plus, to find manufacturers who would develop such products for you is another difficulty, another bottleneck. So with Booth, my target market is radical youth like us who do not have time for self-care or personal care, but they want to indulge in it, and they want to indulge in it on their own terms. So say you're sitting in the cab for 30 minutes going from one place to the other, and you could just get a facial while you're in it. What am I talking about? I'm talking about a sheet mask. And you know, okay, you come back from the office or you come back from internship and you do not have time to wash your hair for the date or for the meeting that you have afterwards. You have 5 minutes to finish that business. What are you going to do? You could use an Ayurvedic dry shampoo powder on your scalp and be happy about it, because the rest of the dry shampoos available in the market are all chemical based, right? So to fill this gap, we created products that are waterless. We're creating shampoo pods, which are packaged like toffees, in sustainable packaging with aluminium and paper, so that you don't throw out anything and you reuse everything. So that when you go out for 2 days, you can just pick up two toffees from that box and just be on your way. You don't need to carry your entire box, or you don't need to use the shampoo in the hotel that probably won't suit your scalp, right? And that is how Booth came into picture. And talking about the next project, which is Sandook. Now, especially from the time when I started visiting a lot of museums and a lot of countries with my family, I come from a family of travelers where our favorite yearly ritual, family ritual, is to go out on a trip wherever and anywhere, I mean, anywhere and everywhere, right after Diwali. So for 7 days, all of us disappear. All of us are together, our phones are bags, and only come out when we need to take pictures. And we explore the culture there. We explore the food there. We explore places. We talk to people. We explore, you know, we experience culture. And so, you know, this appreciation for art and appreciation for artisans comes very naturally. In 2000, I was on a trip. I was on a Euro trip with my family. And I was 10 because I was in 10th grade. I was in 5th grade back then, and I was 10, right? And we were in a nice museum where two of these people, Swati Didi and Aarti Didi, had joined us, who were the daughters of the tour guide that had come with us from India. And they knew everything about London. They knew what places to go to for pizza. They knew which makes me travel. Like a 10-year-old, that was a very innocent thought at 10. But when my friend from school called me to tell me that, you know, I'm planning to do such and such a work where, you know, I want to promote arts and artisans, and I want to export and retail handlooms and handicrafts from India, I jumped at it. That is one of the most beautiful leaps I feel I've taken. In that Monday morning, that was 11 a.m. and that call changed the course of the rest of my life. I was like, yes, I'm going to do it with you. You know, let's do this together. And that is how Sandook was born. It's called Sandook because it's a treasure box of, you know, timeless handlooms and handicrafts that we produce in this country. And, you know, while in the COVID, the art did not or never died. We saw it everywhere. We saw NFTs. We saw digital art coming up. What was happening to these handy artists, or, you know, people who were doing everything by hand, is that they suffered a lot of casualty, be it their income, be it lives, out of poverty, of hunger. And that is what drove us to the point where we decided, okay, you know, this is the idea to go with. And this is something that we need to do. And so with the objective to promote and conserve the art and artisans of the country, we decided that our target market should be 25 to 70 years of, especially women who take these decisions of buying home decor and, you know, apparels and soft furnishing for the house, kitchenware, children's toys, and introduce this e-retailing platform online. And, you know, get artisans earn some. My final message to all of you today is that apart from whatever you're doing right now, if you could just sit with yourself for half an hour and think of the causes that you believe in, you know, maybe for a second, forget to believe in, you know, of those impact or all those changes that you wanted to bring into the world, all those things that you wrote about in your projects or spoke of at college and school presentations. You know, we keep saying that, I want to be the change that I want to see in the world. And only gradually and only through these leaps will you find out as to how you're going to act on these causes or how you can help these causes beyond the words. Words are important. That is how you manifest it, right? But the next step is to actually think how you can support these causes through your work, through your hustle. Because we're not... So here's a leap that I hope none of you all take, because we're talking about, more safer leaps and more calculated ones. And so I thank you for your time and thank you so much for inviting me to the session. This was an amazing experience for me. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. This was amazing. And I request all the participants, if they have any questions, they can ask in the chat box. I'll read out for you guys and get your answers from Rajeshwari.
So I'm sure Rajeshwari, they might be introspecting on what to be asked, because you covered many important aspects that they should know. So my one question to you is, like, being a student of BBA management, how did you thought of diversifying the field when generally after BBA students think of going for MBA ahead and they want to make their, you know, career and future in that? So I just want to know, what was your criteria of taking the decision of not going for MBA, but going for another master's stream? So what exactly were your criteria of selecting a module and the specialization for you? Yeah.
If I'm being very honest, ma'am, I love the fact that, you know, I have these degrees, but for most part, whenever I was in the classroom, be it in BBA or MA, it was mainly about the content that was being imparted to us. And as excited as I was about the graduation ceremony, I think what excited me the most was what I was carrying from there, right? Now, when I was at Oro, I was able to explore a lot of areas, very diverse areas like events and music and, cultural activities like our annual days and things like literary debates or it's not necessary that a career or say a life should be linear. It can be anything that one decides it to be. And when I was, I was thrown into this next phase, which was Good Shepherd, wherein, you know, there were these array of skills that I was learning and being given certificates on that. But again, I think the certificates, while they lie in the drawer, what I carry with me is the contents of the course or the skill that I learned. I mean, if I have a wardrobe malfunction today, I know I can sew it up and I can, you know, make it work. And in my counseling sessions with the dean, wherein I was sharing my literary experiences with her, what she and I noticed is that I was much more excited about my literary experiences than I was about, you know, the other experiences that I've had, as appreciative as I am of that. And that is when we realized that it wouldn't hurt to try, you know, to get into a master's program for English and cultural studies, because it isn't really about, you know, that it's going to be very specific and it's going to be completely different and completely detached from the idea of marketing and profit making businesses. But what ended up happening was that now I feel like I can look at things from a 360 degree perspective, be it social, be it business, be it my own personal perspective, and I can keep them separate because all of these. For me, taking the decision of leaping into an MA was because this is the only time when I can actually follow my calling. And, you know, this is, and maybe I will not get this tomorrow. And coming from a family that supports these decisions and, you know, they always allowed me to have the space to take my own decisions and explore different areas, be out in the world, travel through ISEC, meet people. And that is how I think I ended up taking such a, you know, I don't know what adjective to use for it, but it's definitely was bold to just jump into ME. And when I was in that classroom, I had gone to the class because I had some time before the course started. And I made sure that I read up some of the BA materials so that I'm not all dumbed out when the class starts. And the first thing that our professor said, she was a poetry professor. The first thing that she said after she introduced herself in the class was, "Do not think you know anything. Drop everything that you've learned." And I was blown. I was completely blown because I realized that I'm in for something that I wasn't expecting. And that I think excites me for, you know, whatever has come next and the next to it after that.
So I think now your passion and profession are one, because earlier it might be different and diverted, but now I think you're very clear about your next 10 years, what you're supposed to do, and you actually got a clarity on what exactly should be your, you know, vision and theme and profession. I hope now it is very clear to you as a roadmap. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. At least for the next 10 years, I do know that it will be spent developing and automating Sandook and Booth, because I realize that what I need to be attached to is the causes that I believe in. That is what will drive me. That is what honestly has driven me after I finished, you know, the education, the formal education.
Yes. Yes. So I think Sakshi and Vedanti, you can take up the questions from chat box.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. So we have some questions in the chat box for you. So the first one is, wasn't it hard for you to study so much and manage all of that and still plan to start your own business? So I think they want to know what are the hurdles that you faced and how did you, you know, manage all of that?
So most of my hurdles were knowledge-based. And because, you know, I was leaping into newer stuff every second year. And so what helped me was to develop a will for self-learning. You know, I started reading. My professors used to say, because, you know, what I believe that the two things or the three things that get you by in these situations is something that your teacher said, something that your parents or your family said, or something that you read in a book, and sometimes also what you watched in a film or a series, you know. So there was this one session on why do we study English or why do we study arts, and we had somebody from Germany come in to take up a session at Christ, and he said, why aren't you all studying business, or why aren't you all studying economics, why are you here? So he said that it is important to know business. It is important to know economics and the dynamics of it to survive in the world. But you study arts not just to survive in the world, but it's education for the soul. And this education is not just from the course. It comes from these three sources that I just talked about. Things that your teachers and your professors said, things that your family said to you and they stick with you. And third, the things that you see in media, be it print, be it visual. And I think that is what gets me by. That is what makes all these bottlenecks easier.
That was so well put. And I think there's another question that how do you come to know that you are sure about the particular changes or the particular thoughts that you mentioned?
I'm not sure if I completely comprehend the question. How do you come to know?
I think the person is trying to ask, like, I think you explained about your shift and your change in, you know, the career and stuff. So I think they are trying to ask if how do you know you're completely sure about your decision and it's not a phase?
Believe me, it is a phase. It is absolutely a phase, and the whole idea of, you know, taking a leap is to not really know what is going to come next. I completely, you know, agree with Morgan Housel, and this comes from, you know, a privilege that I have been able or have been allowed to make these decisions for myself. But the whole idea is to stay a little away from certainty and just see what happens next. You know, believe in yourself and you believe in your cause and you move forward with it. There is no other way to do it. I can be in a cocoon. I can be, you know, in my comfort zone, but nothing really is going to happen there. Nothing really has happened there is what I've learned. So only when I stepped out, I met some people, I made some changes, I made some decisions, did I feel the movement in life? You know, it makes you feel it makes you feel alive, and that is what you need to move forward.
And there's one more question by Yukta, and she's asking, what are the difficulties you faced in both the models that you've talked about?
You're talking about Bodh and Sandhuk, I believe, right?
Yeah.
So for Bodh, one of the major difficulties was to find manufacturers who would produce products in smaller quantities. Since it's a smaller startup or say a medium level startup right now, it is very difficult to get somebody who believes in your cause as well. That is where your search narrows down. Even if you convince somebody don't make 10,000, I only need 500 units of something. Okay, they're convinced. But do they believe in your cause? Are they ready to experiment to make something which has not been made in the country as yet? It is waterless beauty is the big thing out there in the world, but it hasn't come or it hasn't been accepted in India as yet. So do you have people believing in you? Do you have these vendors who want to deliver, you know, bite-sized and smaller quantity packaging material to you? These are the bottlenecks that I face. Again, these are all knowledge and network-based bottlenecks, which can be solved by making as many cold calls as you can and talking to as many people that you've ever come across in life and being open about what you really need. Because what I've understood is, you know, you only get what you ask for, and one should not be afraid to ask for it. So I'm not going to be afraid to ask for another session here so that we can talk more and maybe even have some more participants and, you know, talk about different ideas that are popping up in the market or popping out in the world.
That's great. And, you know, even I had one question because even I'm an avid interest in the beauty industry. So, you know, because your brand really stands for sustainability and Ayurveda, and that is the root and soul of the brand. What do you think about the market in India as such? Because Indian beauty started with all of that, but because of the shift in, you know, Western ideology and the things that we see through influencers and actresses and social media, the interest in beauty right now is very Western amongst the youth right now. So how do you think you would, you know, think of bringing that back, that aspect back, and, you know, increase your market as well?
Right. So what I've noticed is that, and, you know, I was talking to a friend of mine who also happens to be my marketing consultant, is that people are more accepting of things that are sold outside than they are of things that are sold here.
Yeah.
And that is one of the reasons why I am planning to take an outside inside approach, wherein I launch a Kickstarter campaign, which, you know, caters to the crowd of the US and countries around it, wherein people pledge, to tell you a little about Kickstarter, it's a crowdfunding platform where people pledge money to your idea. So you don't have to produce your product, you sell an idea there, you get some money, you get some traction from, you know, B2B vendors on that platform. And then you start producing the product, or maybe you've produced it beforehand, but those funds really help. And then you start selling wherever you want, because you already have traction from outside. Once you have content or, you know, sales data from outside, it is easy to sell in here. And also, I do believe that a lot of Indian companies are imitating K-beauty. I'm not going to take names here because that sort of, you know, narrows down the topic, but imitating is something that is not appreciated, is showing the opposite of traction. Now they either want it to be innately Indian, something like a Kama Ayurveda or a Force Essential or something like an Amrutam, or they want it to be K-beauty completely. There is definitely demand popping for something in between, wherein you act, you know, you bring in ideas from outside, you get your own Indian ideas, you make a mix of it, and you present it to people. Somebody like a minimalist has shown a lot of increase in sales, which is again an imitation of K-beauty brands and also American brands like Ordinary. But what they've done is they've brought in Indian sensibility to it, on the basis of ingredients. So say they've used ingredients which are more suitable to the Indian climate and not the ones outside. Yeah. So there is definitely demand popping up there. And plus, being coming from a millennial generation myself, and, you know, studying the Gen Z market also, what we've understood is that as long as your product is exciting, as long as it is something that they haven't seen before, there isn't... that it isn't very difficult to attract sales. I mean, there are a lot of brands out there, and they are doing they're spending a lot of money on their ads. But when it comes to, you know, the product, it has to speak for itself. No matter how much content or ad you develop around it, it has to speak for itself. So, you know, initially the market or the game was about packaging. That if the packaging looks good, feels good, then the market is yours. It's not going to be like that anymore. It is going to be about the product, because products without a packaging are now coming up. Something like a Lush, for example, they closed down their operations in India because it didn't work out for them. But there are a lot of Indian brands trying to make products without packaging, because they just want to reduce their carbon footprint or minimize their use of resources to run their companies.
We have one more question. Since you are so well read, can you suggest us some books that we can read during this crucial phase of our life?
Okay. So there is The Psychology of Money, for sure, that I would recommend. I'm also, coming from publishing industry, I think I've developed that sensibility or that habit of reading anything and everything which is on the table. And I leave it midway if I don't like it, but then I'm open to all content. I'm also reading this book called The Journey Within, which is the second part of the autobiography of Radhanath Swami, because I feel like it sort of grounds me in the sense that it brings me back to my roots and makes space for introspection. So it's about his life and how he became an American guru. Now he's called the American guru, and he is the teacher of Gaur Gopal Das. So that is another book that you could read. And apart from that, I think if you're looking for, looking to answer very basic questions of your conscience, there is a book called Sophie's World by Jostein Gaarder. It's this book wherein an 8-year-old receives an anonymous package which has letters, and those letters are filled with questions like, who are you and why are you here? And it's about a journey of this 8-year-old who is trying to answer these philosophical questions. And it's literally like an entryway or an arc that connects a person who is not thinking about these philosophical questions and a person who wants to. So, you know, it's right in the between. So it's a good entry point if you're looking for one.
All right, that's some great recommendations. And we don't have any questions in the chat box now. So I would request, before we move on to the final goodbyes and thank yous, Rohini ma'am, I would like you to give some closing remarks.
Yes, thanks, Vedanti. And thanks, Rajeshwari. It's really so nice to see, you know, the present batch of students interacting so well with you, connecting so well with you. They're trying to get their answers also from you. And it's really nice that, you know, we are fulfilling the purpose for which we had the masterclass. And I'm sure Monica ma'am will also agree with that. So I just want, I'm really like so impressed, and I'm feeling like, really, is this a student of Aura who has just passed out a few years back? I mean, how are you so sorted in life?
Ma'am, I am not, trust me.
You sounded so much like, you know, you are grounded, you are connected to the roots. The kind of advice that you gave to the students, you know, the interaction that you had where you said, you know, first of all, the thought that you got, because you met so many people, so you collected those thoughts, you built upon it with the intention to do something about it. And then actually you put that intent into action. So these stages, you know, people are not able to cover it completely. Somewhere in between, it is lost. Which you've really done it very well, I feel. And like you said, the three people who, you know, you should listen to, because that is your source of knowledge. And if you just connect those dots, and then to that you add your passion, what you feel like doing, that really, you know, it gives you a soup for the soul, I feel. And it really, like you very well mentioned that, you know, education from the soul. So I really like those, that kind of, you know, an outlook towards education, which is so different, where, you know, you're not just studying to collect certificates, but you're actually putting real life gaps, you're identifying them, you're putting it into practice. So it's not the normal business you're doing, the normal marketing you are doing. But you are doing something where genuinely connecting to the roots, Ayurveda, which was a lost art almost. And like you said, in COVID, many people have started something related to Ayurveda because people realized it during this time. So I feel that is one very, you know, a boon during COVID. Ki what all we used to ignore earlier, we have started reviving it back. And the Indian culture, we are trying to more and more adopt it. And let me tell you one thing where I differ from you is where you said that, you know, earlier it was like that, definitely. Ki agar Indian brands hai, toh it's not accepted in the market because there are Western brands, like even Vedanti said about that, right? But I feel now that the Westerners are looking at India as a, you know, for providing such products, because they know they have failed. They literally know this, that they have failed, and they're looking for better solutions. So I think in that case, Bodh and Sandook, both are going to be a wonderful platform where, you know, you can take it ahead, leaps and bounds. And yes. So also you talked about how, you know, you were shaped at Good Shepherd. ISEC helped you at Oro University. And basically you are trying to build upon your aspirations and you're putting that into action. So it was really wonderful listening to all those things from your end, how, you know, you channelized yourself towards the English and cultural studies at Christ. And how one German came to talk to you and you built upon the things. So it was that Monday morning, 11 a.m.?
Yes.
And today also we started at Monday morning, 11 a.m.
Something about this time and this day.
Yeah, exactly. So, and of course, your COVID poem was really very nice. Very nice.
Thank you, ma'am. I almost, you know, removed it from the structure because I felt like, is it going to be too much? So I'm like, no, you know, let this be.
No. When something comes from the heart, you know, it's original and it connects. So, yeah, it was really wonderful session and the book recommendations, I'm sure students will look forward to that and, you know, take a note of that also. And yes, thank you for the wonderful interaction, Rajeshwari. We would really like to have you offline at the campus sometime in future.
Absolutely, ma'am. I'm actually looking forward to, you know, being at the campus and meeting you all in person, having a good chat. I really miss the library and the discussion rooms there.
Right.
Really, really nice project sessions and discussions in there. I would love to be there. And thank you so much for inviting me for today's session. It was a great opportunity for me to, you know, talk about what I'm doing and, you know, connect back with Monica, ma'am, with you, with the students. It's just amazing to be here. I'm so glad we did this.
So nice of you. And once again, thank you on behalf of Oro University for being here and sharing your experience. And now I request Vedanti to take it forward. Thank you, Rajesh.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Yes.
In the middle, I'm so sorry.
No.
I wanted, you know, if all of you could get connected to the both communities. So I'm just going to post the link to its IG in the chat box here. There is even a web page attached to it where you could, you know, sign up for a free goodie or drop in your email to get to know more or join the team, because we're open to new talent in the team and really looking forward to having people who are interested in the personal care brand or they're interested in, you know, different aspects of running a startup. So please, we welcome you with open arms there. Thank you so much.
So that's another one of our aims fulfilled, you know, where students can connect with you for internships and probably you can take it forward from there.
Would love to.
Yeah.
Okay, that's great. So the participants, make sure you check that. And now taking the session forward, I would request Sakshi to give a formal vote of thanks before we go. Thank you, Vidhanti. Firstly, I'd like to thank Ms. Rajeshwari for enlightening us with her knowledge. The webinar was full of knowledge as well as interesting things. It is truly said that sometimes we need to lose ourselves and we need to take a leap. We might connect with a passion and which will basically help us in fulfilling our aspirations. So once again, thank you for enlightening us with your knowledge and taking our time from your busy schedule. Thank you so much. Further, I would like to thank Rama sir, VC, Oro Registrar. Moreover, I would like to thank our Dean Rohit sir and HOD Monica ma'am for giving us permission to organize the masterclass, as well as the coordinators for the masterclass, Rohini ma'am and Krupa ma'am, as well as all the other faculty members for such an amazing session. Last but not the least, I would like to thank all the students present here for paying attention as well as learning. The webinar would have been incomplete without a proper dialogue and participation from the students. So thank you to all the fellow students through their participation. Last but not the least, thanks to the IT department for the smooth flow of the webinar. Thank you so much.
Yeah, and thanks to Vedanti and Sakshi for taking it forward so wonderfully. Right. Thank you, Rajeshwari. See you sometime on campus.
Yes, ma'am. Please yeah. Let me know when
the campus. My team will connect with you for internship also. We are having winter internship commencing from first week of Jan. And I expect you to please give chance to few of your, younger siblings to be the part of your organization. Whosoever has interest in the beauty care products or the natural products, I think we'll identify a handful of students who are keenly interested in that, not just for the sake of certificate, but who would like to take this project forward and who, who may in future can be the part of your team as well, right? So we surely facilitate the same. Thank you. Thank you so much for your presence. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajeshwari. Wonderful session. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Lovely meeting you. And yeah, looking forward to meeting you in person.
Definitely, definitely. Same here.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rajeshwari.
Thank you, Kruma ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Vedanti, Sakshi. Bye-bye. Bye, ma'am.
Bye-bye.
Bye.